Welcome to Weld.com. I'm Paul Brown, and today we're going to talk about copper. Not this kind of you dirty copper, but the copper that we find in our everyday life with electrical, plumbing, ships, machinery, you name it, it's everywhere. We use 87 billion pounds a year. And for you guys at home in your garage, you could be making some really great looking art with copper. So let's go check out how to weld copper. Let's talk about what copper is. It was the first metal smelted 5,000 years ago, and it's a very ductile material. It conducts electricity really, really, really good. It's very corrosion resistant. It also is a good heat conductor. When welding it, it conducts heat so well, 5 times more than steel does, it takes a little bit different technique to get it to work right for you. Oh, hey, I was just checking out my Lincoln book here. I'm not an expert on copper because there's a lot of different types. Oxygen-free or electrolytic tough pitch copper, deoxidized copper, red brass, Muntz metal, silicon bronze, phosphor bronze, cupro nickel, and aluminum bronze. And each one has different welding characteristics, whether good or bad. And the copper we're welding today, this right here and all these other samples, is deoxidized copper. The big book says that it works really good with TIG, with DC electrode negative, and we want to use a ERCU-SI-A, which is silicon bronze, or if we want good conductivity with electrical, we want to use an RCU, which is deoxidized copper. And it's got really good strengths, and we should be able to weld up to 1/8 of an inch with straight argon, and over 1/8 of an inch, we want to add a little helium to it. Before we get welding, let's talk a little bit about safety. As you can see, I have my respirator on, and I highly recommend it if you're welding on copper, stainless, or you're in an area where you can't get away from the fumes or your head might be over the fumes. Real important, because copper has more contaminants coming out of it than regular steel does. The other thing is we want a good pair of gloves because copper conducts electricity real well, and you do have a better chance of getting shocked with it. So be very careful what you're doing with it. And of course, we have our helmet, and this is an auto darkening helmet, and which I think is great because it allows you to see what you're doing. We need to clean our material too beforehand. Now this was cleaned with a solvent, acetone, and we've put the solvent away so we don't catch it on fire. And then I scrub it with a Scotch-Brite pad on a grinder, or I can do it by hand, or a wire brush. I'm old and lazy, so I use the grinder, and it works great and gives us this kind of a look. As far as our wire is concerned, we also want to clean it. Give it a few swipes with a Scotch-Brite pad. And we have different types of wire. This is from the welding supply. This is the ERCU wire. You can actually take a piece of Romex and pull the ground lead out, like I've done here. Clean it with your Scotch-Brite. And this is some crazy stuff that my friend gave me that was pure copper screening that they clipped up for a design they were doing. We're going to weld with it also and see how well it does, because it's pure copper. This little guy here is our argon helium splitter valve. And we're going to be starting out with just straight argon, and then we're going to mix the two together, so we'll have an argon helium mix, about 50-50, and then we'll go to a straight helium so we can see the difference in how much penetration the helium adds. And for what we're doing to begin with, we aren't really going to need that helium. Okay, let's turn on our machine. And the little guys in there are spinning the wheels and in the hamster cage. Okay, we're going to select our polarity. This is AC, this is DC, we want DC. We're going to select our process, which is TIG, high frequency arc start. The output is remote, and we're using a foot pedal. And the waveform, we're not doing anything with it because that's only on AC. We're setting our amps to 250. Oop, there we go. And I can change the amps right here. So that's our maximum amps that we'll be getting. And so we're ready to go now. Now I'm slightly pulsing this to control the puddle and the heat input. That heat is definitely getting hotter. And just like stainless, I'm keeping the gas on it for a long time because copper has an affinity for oxygen. Okay, here's a little weld that we did with the ERCU. We were running about 100 amps, even though we had the machine set at 250. You might have noticed I was pulsing it with my foot control just to control the puddle and keep it from burning through. As we went along, the heat built up really fast. And the further away I got from the start, I was probably down to about 50 amps. And we did have burn through on the back. Now this is 1/16 inch material. So it shows you don't need that much power with argon to weld this. All the blackening that's on there is oxidation. Before I can weld on this again, I need to knock that off with a brass or bronze brush. So let me do that real quick, like, and then we could throw another bead on it. There's our ERCU rod that we bought. Next time I'm going to use some copper wire that came out of the Romex, and we can see if there's a difference in that with porosity or mill scale or anything like that. So let's get at it. Let's do one pure helium. Okay, I'm gonna clean this pure helium one off. You might have noticed how much faster I was cruising with it. I'm gonna put this helium argon one. Had to move a little slower with that one. And then we've got the straight argon one over here. Here was our first coupon we did, and we used the regular rod we got from the welding supply. And then this is the rod that my buddy gave me that was part of a mesh screen that was pure copper. And this is 1/16 inch with pure argon. And you can see how much burn through we had, even running it below 80 amps and pulsing it by hand. Now this was a 50-50 helium argon mix. And this is 1/8 instead of 1/16 material. And that, you can see how much melt through we got on that. It's pretty impressive. Here was the last one, which really the arc started immediately, the puddle did. And you might have been able to see the difference in color of the helium gas, which is bright orange, or at least it looked orange under my hood. The arc puddle started immediately, and we actually welded it to the table with the burn through was so much. So that's some pretty serious penetration. That shows you what helium does. But in reality, for doing 1/16th or even 1/8th, you don't need the helium. But once you get over 1/8 inch material, like a quarter or something like that, then the helium would definitely come in handy. Okay, we're gonna take this 1/4 inch bus bar, which is much bigger and thicker than what we've been welding on, and do a straight argon bead, see if we can melt it with 250 amps. As soon as I'm done doing that, I'm gonna go run to the bathroom, throw it in the toilet, and then come back and we're gonna do a straight helium on it. The filler rod I'm using is the wire that came out of that Romex wire, and we're gonna see how that runs also, because it is an alternative that you might wanna consider, because the ERCU is hard to get at most welding supply places. Can't even get it to melt. Can't even get it to melt. Let's go ahead and crank up the amperage a little bit. 375, let's see what that does. Obviously my electrode was a little too small, it just blew off the end. Okay, I've cleaned the oxide off of here, so I can try to do another weld on there. It's still got a little heat buildup from when I originally tried to blow my tungsten apart. I've got a 50-50 argon helium mix on this one, and I'm gonna do some preheat with the torch by just running it back and forth and see how well that'll work. So let's give that a shot. Boy, that preheat and that helium really helped. And take note, this is really, really hot. You need to hold your torch far back or get thicker gloves than what I have on. And these are not the thinnest TIG gloves you can get. You might have noticed just how fast I was running with that. And that was with that filler wire I got out of the Romex, which slows out really nice. I think it actually works better than the stuff we got at our welding supply place. Let me go cool this off. I'm gonna do 100% helium right after this. I'll be right back. Okay, we're a high-tech cooling device. Man, that thing was still hot. Ooh, baby. Don't let your wife catch you doing this. See all that scaling copper oxide coming off of there? Okay, now that we got this all cooled off, I'm gonna run 100% helium. I'm gonna use my special rod that I got for doing, what do they call that, fish scales or stachydons? Let's see how this works. Man, that's hot, 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 hot. Boy, that went a lot faster. I hope you can see that weird orange glow that the helium causes. And if anybody says anything about my shaky rod, it's because I had this thing so long and I couldn't really slide it in my hand, and I was trying to keep my hand from getting burned up. But what I want to do is wire brush this real quick. Let you see how nice that bead looks. And that is a pure copper wire I'm using there. Okay, whew. I think I need another trip to the bathroom. How's that look? Yeah. This thing will actually change color even after taking the mill scale off of it, because it's still hot enough to react to the atmosphere of the oxygen. I don't know if I'd call it mill scale, maybe just copper oxide. About 15 seconds with Scotch-Brite, there you go, man. Look at that. That's the one nice thing about copper is that mill scale comes off real easy. Okay, welders, who's ready to go do some copper? We just showed you really don't need to have helium except for really thick material. As a matter of fact, yesterday when I was welding and doing some tests, this is just a little bit bigger than 1/64th. It's 0.021 thousandths of an inch. And you might be able to see the bead right there. Came out pretty nice. I was really impressed what I could do with it. I did have to use filler to act as a heat sink on it. The other thing I wanted to point out is this gigantic gas lens cup. One of the reasons for doing that was to have the electrode out far enough where you could see what we're doing, but also the copper really needs to be shielded from oxygen or it oxidizes. And you saw that on some of the blackness of things. So by having this big cup, I had a lot more gas coverage, something like you'd want to use on stainless or titanium. This guy here really showed what helium can do as far as added heat. I mean, I've never seen an electrode blow up like that before. I've had it melt, but never blow up and shoot into the material. So I hoped you liked that. By the way, I had not welded any copper in 32 years. And the first time I ever welded copper, it was at a friend's place. And it was the first time I'd ever done TIG. I was not a welder then. He said, here, try this. You'll like it. You'll like it. Well, it looked terrible. So if you're going to do copper, make sure you do some tests on things, get a little practice. It's nothing like steel due to that 5 times the amount of heat transfer. The puddle is very sluggish. I had to pulse the power on it off and on manually. And you really can't dab filler metal into it real easily because of the amount of heat that's around. And the copper is melting at 1900 degrees instead of the usual 2700, 2800 of stainless or steel. So even keeping the electrode or the filler way out, it was still melting before I ever got anywhere near it. Thanks for watching today. If you have questions or need help, go to our forum and connect with us at weld.com/forum. If you want to check out exclusive content and member perks, join our channel and support the weld.com community. And we'll see you on the next one.